हेलो एवरीवन, दिस साइड मनीषा मिश्रा, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन मैथमेटिक्स अप्लाइड साइंस डिपार्टमेंट एट सेंट्रल इंडियंस इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी एंड मैनेजमेंट गुड़गांव. दिस कॉलेज इज अफिलिएटेड टू मेहरुद्दीन यूनिवर्सिटी रोहतक. सो टुडे आई विल डिस्कस द टॉपिक डायग्राम्स एंड ग्राफ्स. राइट, सो दिस इज योर फर्स्ट यूनिट एंड लास्ट टॉपिक्स. राइट, सो before diagrams I just discussed two points, primary and secondary data. Right, so let's see primary and secondary data. Always there is ask 10 marks, 8 marks question in your semester exam. So what do you mean by collection of data? Differentiate between primary and secondary data. This is 8 marks question, right? And this question already was in, asked in your final semester exam. So, collection of data is the basic activity of statistical science. It means collection of facts and figures relating to particular phenomenon under the study of any problem, whether it is in business, economics, social or natural science, right? So first, if you are collecting a data, then you should know very well about your data. Problem is the data can be from anything, related to anything, but you should have basic knowledge of your data, right? Examples are business, economics, social or natural science. Such material can be obtained directly from the individual units called primary sources. So primary sources means individual units, means directly what you are getting. But if you are getting information belonging to anyone, or it is coming passing through from anyone, then our data will be secondary data. So sources are from the material published earlier elsewhere known as the secondary sources. That means if information is coming directly to you, that it is primary data. If it is coming through another person or another material, then it will be your secondary data, right? Now, difference between primary and secondary data. So primary data and secondary data, so basic nature. So basic natures are, primary data are original and are collected for the first time, right? These are the original information. Secondary data which are collected earlier by someone else and which are now in published or unpublished state. Second point, collecting agency. So this is also a second, depend what is collecting agency. These data are collecting by the investigator himself. Secondary data were collected earlier by some other person. Post collection alternations. These data do not need alternation as they are according to the requirement of the investigation. Secondary data, these have to be analyzed and necessary changes have to made to make them useful as per the requirements of investigation, right? If you have some information, then you can use that information directly. Otherwise, you will change two or three points in that information, in that points, then that information will be your secondary information, right? Time and money. More time, energy and money has to be spent in collection of these data. Comparatively less time and money is to be spent in secondary data, right? So these are the difference. Now, there is another question here. Write a note on the editing of primary data and secondary data for the purpose of analysis and interpretation, right? So before analysis and interpretation, it is necessary to edit the data to detect possible errors and inaccuracies so that accurate and impartial results may be obtained. Thus, editing means the process of checking for the errors and omissions and making corrections. That means if there is any error there, then you will correct that and you should remove the error, then making correction if necessary, right? The task of editing is a highly specialized one and requires high level of skill and carefulness to attain the proper degree of accuracy. Now, editing of primary data. So while editing primary data, we need to remember these 3 to 4 points, right? So first point is editing for consistency. Second point, editing for completeness. Third point, editing for accuracy, and editing for uniformly or homogeneity, right? So first point is editing of secondary data. Sorry, second point is editing of secondary data. So since secondary data have already been obtained, it is highly desirable that a proper scrutiny of such data is made before they are used by investigator. Now, there is a writer here, Bolli, rightly points out that secondary data should not be accepted at their face value. Hence, before using secondary data, the investigator should consider the following aspects. Whether the data are suitable for the purpose of investigation in view. So quite often, secondary data do not satisfy immediate needs because they have been compiled for the other purpose. The variation can be in units of measurement, variation in the date, period to which data is related, etc. Right? So secondary data means data, you are getting second information, right, related to data. Now, whether the data is adequate for the investigation. So adequacy of data is to be judged in the light of requirements of the survey and the geographical area covered by the available data. For example, if our object is to study the wage rates of the workers in sugar industry in India, and the available data cover only the state of Rajasthan, it would not serve the purpose, right? So this is the example of the secondary data to adequate for the investigation. Third, whether the data are reliable. The following points should be checked to find out the reliability of secondary data. First one, the collecting agency by unbiased. Second one, the enumerators are properly trained. Third one, a proper check on the accuracy of the field work, and was the editing, tabulating, and analysis carefully and consistently, right? So first one, if you have a data, so I told you that it would be knowledgeable. Tabulating means construction of table, table number, stub, anything, header, note, footnote. It should be well organized. Now, diagrams. So, what is diametric representation? State the importance of diagrams. So, this is also 8 marks question. So, depicting of a statistical data in the form of attractive shapes such as the bars, circles, and rectangles is called diametric presentation. In computer, we can see, we can make another curve like a circle, hectagon, pentagon, these types of bar and rectangles. So these are the graphic presentation, right? These are the diagrams. So a diagram is a visual form of presentation of statistical data, highlighting their basic facts and relationship. There are geometrical figures like lines, bar, squares, rectangles, circles, curves, etc. Diagrams are used with great effectiveness in the presentation of all types of data. When properly constructed, they readily show information that might otherwise be lost amid the details of numerical tabulation. Now, what is the importance of data? Right? So, importance of diagrams. A properly constructed diagram appeals to the eye as well as the mind, since it is practical, clear, and easily understandable. Even by those who are unacquainted with the methods of presentation, utility or importance of diagrams will become clear from the following points. So first point is attractive and effective means of presentation. So beautiful lines full of various colors and signs attract human sight. Yes, it is clear. And do not strain the mind of the observer. A common man who does not wish to indulge in figures, get messages from a well-prepared diagram. If you're watching a diagram and if your diagram is very clear, then you can obtain so many information only from the diagrams, right? Now, it means your diagram should be attractive. Second point, make data simple and understandable. So the mass of complex data when prepared through diagram can be understood easily. According to Sri Moran, diagrams help us to understand the complete meaning of a complex numerical situation at one side only. So in mathematics, there are so many curves we use and to watch the curves, and we will get so many information, and we also get so many information about watching the curves only, right? Third point, facilitate comparison. So diagrams make comparison possible between two sets of data of different periods, reasons, or other facts by the putting side or by side through diametric presentation. So facilitate comparison. If you have two data, then you can compare with both of them. Now, fourth point is same time and energy. Save time and energy. So the data which will take hours to understand becomes clear by just having a look out at total facts represented through diagrams. Yeah, it is clear that if you are watching a diagram, then you can get information only by the seeing the diagram. You don't have to read or study the so much information, right? So it is as time consuming. It is a time saver. Fifth point, universal utility. Because of its merits, the diagrams are used for presentation of statistical data in different areas. It is widely used technique in economic, business, administration, social, and other areas. Next point, helpful in information communication. So a diagram depicts more information than the data shown in a table. Information concerning data to general public becomes more easy through diagrams and gets into the mind of a person with ordinary knowledge. Right, there is another question here. Explain in brief the various types of diagrams. That means types of diagrams here. The different types of diagrams can be divided into following heads. So first one, the one-dimensional diagrams, two-dimensional diagrams, three-dimensional diagrams, fourth, pictograms and cartograms. So one-dimensional diagrams or bar diagrams, right? This is also called bar diagrams. So bar diagrams are the most common types of diagrams. A bar is a thick line whose width is shown merely for attention. They are called one-dimensional because it is only the length of the bar that matters and the width does not matter, right? So it only considers length. So it is called one-dimensional, right? There are kinds of bar diagrams. Bar diagrams are 10 to 11 types, divides into 10 to 11 parts, right? So first one, line diagrams. When the number of items is large, but the proportion between the maximum and minimum is low, lines may be drawn to economize space. Only individual or time series are represented by these diagrams. Time series we will discuss in our fourth unit, right? Second diagram, simple bar diagram. A simple bar diagram is used to represent only one variable. For example, the figures of sales, production, etc. of various years may be shown by means of simple bar diagram. The bars are of equal width, only the length varies. These diagrams are appropriate in case of individual series, discrete series, and time series. Third one, multiple bar diagrams. In a multiple bar diagrams, two or more sets of interrelated data are represented. Different shadows, shades, colors, or dots are used to distinguish between the bars. These are used to compare two or more related variables based on time and place. Subdivided bar diagrams. If a bar is divided into more than one part, it will be called subdivided bar diagrams. Each component occupy a part of the bar proportional to its share in the total. For example, total expenditure incurred by a family on various items such as food, clothing, education, house, and that means you have your salary and you are dividing your salary in education, food, clothes, house rent, etc. So this is the subdivide, means divide se bhi subdivide ho raha, right? Means of subdivided diagrams. Percentage subdivided bar diagrams. Percentage subdivided bar diagrams are particularly useful to measure relative changes of data. When such diagrams are prepared, the length of the bar is kept equal to 100 and segments are cut in these bars to represent the component of an aggregate, right? Next, profit loss diagrams. If relative changes of cost and sales or profit or loss are to be represented with the help of bars, then profit loss diagram are constructed. These diagrams are similar to percentage subdivided bars and are prepared in the same way. Next, duodirectional bar diagrams. In duodirectional bar diagrams, comparative study of two major parts of data is represented in a single bar, right? Such duodirectional diagrams are represented on both sides of horizontal axis. It means above and below the baseline. Next one, paired bars. If two different information which are in different units are to be presented, then paired bar diagrams are used. These bars are not vertical but horizontal, and the first scale is in the first half and the second scale is in the second half. Next, deviation bar diagrams. Deviation bars are popularly used for representing net quantities and net profit, net loss, net exports or net imports, etc. Such bars can have both positive or negative values. Positive values are shown above the baseline and negative values below the baseline. So there are three parts more: progressive chart or Gantt chart, pyramid bar diagram and sliding bar diagrams, right? So these are the three next points you can see here. Now, second is two-dimensional diagrams. In two-dimensional diagrams, the height as well as the width of the bars will be considered. That means here, length and height and width both are considering. So this is two-dimensional. The area of the bars represents the magnitude of the data. Such diagrams are also known as area diagrams or surface diagrams. Yes, if you are taking two dimensions, then it will be your area. You can say it is area or surface. The important types are rectangle diagram, square diagram, circle of or pie diagram. So in rectangle, we will see length and width. So it is two dimensional. Square diagram, it is also a two-dimensional diagrams because length and width are considering. Circle also, because there is an angle and a radius, so also 2 points will be here, or pie diagram, right? Three-dimensional diagrams. In three-dimensional diagrams, length, width and height are taken into consideration. If the difference between the minimum and maximum value is so wide as it is difficult to represent them by square or circle diagram, then 3D diagram is used. For this, cubic roots of the given numbers is calculated. 3D diagrams include cubes, blocks, sphere and cylinder. Because in cubes you also need height, weight and width and length, and blocks, spheres and cylinders, right? Now our next next our topic related to bar diagram, and it is what is graph, right? So what is graphic presentation? So according to M.M. Blair, the simplest to understand, the easiest to make, the most variable and the most widely used type of chart is graph. The simplest to understand, okay, the easiest to make means you can draw easily, the most variable and the most widely used type of chart is your graph. Graphic presentation is a visual form of presenting statistical data. Graph acts as a tool of analysis and makes complex data simple and intelligible. Graphs are more appropriate in the following cases. If tendency instead of real measurement is important, when comparative study of many data series is required on one graph. If estimation and interpolation are to be present by graph. If frequency distribution is presented by two or more curves, right? So this is your graphic presentation. What are the various types of graph of frequency distribution? So frequency distribution can also be presented by means of graphs. Such graph facilitate comparative study of two or more frequency distribution as regard their shape and pattern. The most commonly used graph are as follows: line frequency diagram, histogram, frequency polygon, frequency curves, cumulative frequency curve, or Ojain curves. Right. So these are the points of diagram graphic graphs. And this is also 8 marks question. So guys, just prepare. And I have completed your unit first. And next section, I will start your unit fourth. Right? Thank you.